Holy smokes. This year has completely flown on by. I cannot believe it is already almost October in a couple weeks. But September is one of the most important months for winterizing your colonies, and there are four main things that can kill your hives this September that you don't want to happen. So I'm going to cover those four things and some things that you should do to hopefully help prevent it. Bit of a side note before we get into the video, it is so crazy to me that it's been exactly a year now since I completely shook up my life. It is so crazy to me how much has changed, how much I have changed. It makes me a little bit proud, but at the same time, there's still a lot of work I gotta do. But so if any of you guys ever feel this kind of thing during fall time, I swear there's like a lot of energy in the fall. It seems that like this is the time that my life always starts to like shake up a little bit. I don't like it, but I do like it. It's always been good for me, but at the same time, I don't like it. Is anyone else with me on that? But okay, just want to talk a little bit about my life a little bit. Let's get back into the video. All right, so the first big thing that can take out your hives in September, which I'm sure you've heard many times before, is Varroa mites and parasitic mite syndrome. This is the time of year that you're going to see any sort of sicknesses that are in your colony start to pop up. So if you have any viruses, you're gonna end up seeing that. If you have any bacterial infections, if you have a high mite load, you're really going to start, what are you doing there? Oh my gosh, it's eating the head of a bee. Like, do you see that? Yeah, no, that ain't gonna fly. Sorry, buddy. Woo! Okay, now it's mad. That did not work. I should have had my gloves on. But anyways, so Varroa mites are really going to start building up in your colonies right now this time of year, because the problem is your population of bees are now starting to go down. And because of that, there's going to be more mites per bee, because the mites have been breeding all summer long. So there's now more than they had starting off in the springtime. So as the population of bees go down, the mites population keeps breeding, and then it ends up being, like I said, mites on every single bee, which will then end up collapsing the colony because every single bee is being parasitized and pretty much getting the life sucked out of them. Because right now you should have winter bees in your colony. They've been breeding winter bees since the beginning of August, and those bees, it's absolutely essential that they are strong. So they have enough of that vitellogenin that I always talk about to help carry them through the winter, so that they have enough, like an energy reserve. And it also acts as their immune system and their ability to be able to produce brood food when it gets late into the winter and early springtime when they're trying to rear brood again. So it's really important to have a lower number of mites. Now, like I've said before, Casey and I are fully treatment free, so this is going to be an interesting year, and I'm going to keep things 100% raw and honest with you guys on how everything goes in this yard this winter. We did kind of reset our genetics this year when we brought in those pollination hives, so we have no idea what's going to happen. But all we know is if we're going to keep breeding the strain of bee that we want, then this is what's going to have to happen so that we achieve that. So in terms of lowering your mite count this time of year, it is a little bit late to be doing that. You really should have been treating for mites back in August when they were producing winter bees. But if you haven't, you can still try to save the colony and see what happens. I did treat with oxalic acid, a vapor, last year, and it was like September, honestly like early October also. And it actually seemed to help some of the colonies. So there is some hope still. If you do have to treat your colonies, just be careful what you do select to do that with. And I do have a couple videos talking about those things, so definitely go and check those out. All right, so the second biggest killer of hives in September, which I am seeing right now in some of these nukes over here, as you're seeing empty spots, is robbing. Oh my gosh, is the robbing so bad this year. We had a really good flow in the springtime.
then a complete dearth throughout the summer. And then it slowly started to trickle back on as goldenrod started to bloom, but it still wasn't a heavy enough flow to really kind of prevent that robbing. So honestly, I'm seeing a lot of these bees like robbing each other back and forth, and it's been a really big issue. Now we do have a lot of hives condensed in here right now. We have around 74. So 8 of them are at a different yard, and then we also have some at our house. So they're not all right here, but the majority of them are right here. And when you have a lot of bees in a very small condensed area, they're gonna start robbing each other. What they're doing is they're going in and they're stealing all of the resources so that the colony then has absolutely nothing to survive off of or rear brood from. And what ends up happening is when there's no resources in the hive like that, the queen is like, okay, I can't lay more eggs because we can't feed them because we have no food. So it then causes them to have to make their brood nest even smaller, so it could eventually collapse the colony. And not only that, but bad robbing and actually Varroa mites can cause really bad absconding this time of year. So absconding is when the hive like literally just up and leaves. I had that problem last year when I moved all of my colonies in October. I moved them to a different location and some of them rebelled against it and they were not happy whatsoever. This year, like I said, we're having really bad robbing. So I'm seeing some colonies up and leave, and I'm kind of noticing that I think they are going into other colonies here in the yard, because I'll have a colony that's just kind of like mediocre, medium, and then I lose a couple colonies and all of a sudden that colony is booming, like absolutely booming. So colonies are joining each other right now. I was panicking a little bit like a week ago, and Casey was like, hey, remember, we are completely survival stock breeders, so anything that doesn't make it this time of year, we don't want them anyways. Because the bees are really kind of selecting what queens they like the most right now and how they are leaving queens and joining other colonies. So if the queen is not up to their standards, it's not up to our standards either. So trying to remind myself that it's okay if we lose some this year, because we have a different goal in mind. So, but if robbing is really bad for you right now in your yard, a couple of things that you can do is, first off, you can have your colonies all kind of separated. How I have them right here is half the problem, because they're all so close together, and then how I have like hives facing each other, so they can literally just keep going back and forth. You don't want that to happen. You want all the entrances facing different directions. So if you can, spread your hives out as much as possible, especially if you're a backyard beekeeper. And then also, if you notice, I have some of these entrances reduced down to the smallest I possibly can. This is going to give them less of an entrance to have to guard and defend off from different invaders and robbing and whatnot. And then I also have some screen over here on this one that if you don't have entrance reducers and you want to get some airflow in there, pop a screen on there, cut some little bee doors, and you can make the entrance as small as possible. But then in terms of really kind of like helping them get going again, the only thing you can do is just give them more bees, more brood, or combine them with another colony. So yeah, if robbing's bad, let me know, because I want to hear if it's not only us that's having problems with robbing this year, if it's also you. Like, see, oh my gosh. Look at this bee graveyard. These are all the bees that have been fighting each other. Like, oh my gosh, there's so many right here. This is ridiculous. Why are they all the way over here? This is kind of scary. Okay. All right, so the third biggest killer of a colony in September, I actually had happen, and I'm trying so hard to save them. And that is what happened to this colony right here. The swarm impulse was triggered. I went into it the last week of August and saw that there were swarm cells. So I pulled out the queen. I moved her into a different box in order to simulate like an artificial swarm so that she wouldn't leave me. Generally as a general rule of thumb, whenever you see swarm cells, that queen is gonna leave. It's already been triggered. It doesn't matter what you do. I would not ever remove the cells and keep the queen in there, because she'll leave and then that hive will be queenless. I've had that happen to me 3 times before, didn't realize what was happening until the third time I was like, wait a second. Oh, that's why they're queenless. But anyway, so I did that. I moved her into a different box. But the problem is, when that happened, the hive completely gave up. They stopped either one defending their colony, or maybe some of the bees left. I'm not really sure, but all of the honey, there was an entire top box full of capped honey, and now there's no honey in it whatsoever. So they completely gave up because they were queenless. So when I reintroduced the queen back, now it's like they're having to start off from zero again. So it's going to be interesting to see how they do. I might have to condense them down. I'm trying to bulk them up as much as possible and feed them with like a 2-to-1 sugar, water ratio. So we'll see how that goes. But if you don't catch your hive in time and they do end up swarming on you, that is going to be really bad for your hive. There is hope. If you really kind of baby them, it might be able to boost them enough to make it through the winter time. But having a queen have to mate this late is not ideal. I've already been seeing a lot of these colonies kicking out their drones. The drones will like try to walk into the colony, and then like you'll see them like turn back around with a worker bees chasing them. So it's that time of year that's going to be really hard to get a queen mated well. And the weather is not really predictable. It's a little bit chilly. So you definitely don't want to have to start over from a queen cell this time of year. So this is kind of another thing that Casey and I look at when breeding our queens. So that is the only colony that has tried to swarm in this yard. But in the past, I've had a lot of colonies try to swarm this time of year. Those are not the bees that we want. Especially considering that they all started off with a brood break and a brand new queen this year. So there's no reason for them to have to swarm again this year. And I say again, because I did a lot of artificial swarms this year. So I would trigger it in them. I would let them start the swarm response. And then I would split, move them around, use their queen cells, produce more queens, and yada, yada, yada. So any hives that do try to swarm this time of year, I also am kind of like, well, do we really want those genetics if they're trying to swarm this late? That means that they're not really prepping for winter how they're supposed to. So remember, how you treat your bees is how you're always going to have to treat your bees. So keep that in mind. All right. So the last thing that can really kill your hive this time of year, which I've kind of already touched on, is not having enough food in the colony. Because right now the hive is preparing for winter and they're adjusting their brood size dependent upon how much food they have. Because they're going to see, okay, we have this much food, which means we need to have a cluster that's only this big so that we don't run out of food stores in the middle of the winter time. They're really trying to plan out right now all of their, like how they're going to go through the winter and survive it and whatnot. So if they don't have enough food, they're going to shrink their brood nest as much as possible. Only thing is, if they have a small brood nest, they're really going to struggle to keep warm once it does hit those colder temps in the winter time, because they're not going to have as many bees to keep them warm and to really warm up the queen and all of the brood. And it's going to be even harder for them to get going in the springtime because they have a small brood nest. It takes bees to make bees. So honestly, getting on some 2-to-1 feed on your colonies is really important if they are light this time of year. Now, if you have an entire top box full of honey, this is all you need. You don't need anything else. You don't need another medium on top of that. You don't need to feed your hives. If this box is full of honey, you are good to go. You honestly can just close them up and not check on them again until springtime. I know that's like a little stressful, especially for new beekeepers, but it's true. I actually have a colony, my OG colony over here that I named Chicote. That is the colony she is. I never put sugar on her. I just close her up and I don't touch her again. And I always come back in the springtime and she is usually booming. Like, look at how many bees are on this front porch. They are doing great. I guess one more little bonus thing is it is small hive beetle season right now. Especially if you live in a wooded area like where I'm at right now with all of our colonies, the small hive beetles thrive in cool, wet environments. So whenever I open these tops, I'm seeing a lot of small hive beetles. So I would definitely suggest getting something like this.
Now, I don't think it's weak anymore. No, does that look weak to all of you? That's hive beetle prevention.
Oh.
It's a biological hive beetle. Polyester works pretty good.
No. It was a 4x4.
And so how does it feel?
The beetle crawls in, can't get back out because the wings are sticking out. They crawl in and can't back up.
Okay. Neat. I've never heard of that.
Where do you get the polyester from?
Joanne Fabric.
Okay. That's awesome. Joanne Fabric, we're here to do.
But okay, I hope that was helpful, and I hope your colonies are looking really good and really strong going into winter time. That has been Casey and I's main focus this year. Last year I pushed a lot of limits, like you guys saw, a little bit too late in the year. So this year I've been really just kind of pulling that back and going to the opposite spectrum and just making sure every hive is extremely strong and not really worrying about numbers. So yes, we didn't hit 100 hives this year. I mean, we did have 100 hives there for a minute, but we also sold a lot of nukes this year. So yeah, that's okay. We realized that we didn't really need 100 nukes to achieve everything we've been trying to do, goal-wise and whatnot. And 100 hives is a lot to manage when you're working a full-time job and the YouTube and the website that I'm building and everything else. Oh, hey, I got a little friend coming to say hi. Little black kitten. but anyways, okay. Like I always say, I hope that was helpful, and if you have any questions, feel free to drop them in the comments, and I will always answer them. And, oh, also, that virtual class, registration closes on October 2nd, so make sure you head on over to the website and sign up so that you don't miss it. I'm going to be talking about the three main killers of hives in the wintertime: moisture, starvation, isolation starvation as well, and Varroa mites. So there's going to be a lot of info packed in it, so make sure you grab your pencil and notebook, and oh, he's coming to say hi. Aw. But anyways, okay, I'm out of here. Don't quit and be fit.